Yes, I'm using it in a sales context, but it happens to any of us, all of us, who engage in conversation with other people, and surely we all do that. You just have a hard time understanding each other. You have a hard time getting on the same page. You have a hard time connecting that way. I don't mean you have a hard time connecting in that you introduce each other, you know who they are, and maybe you get their business card, and you connect in that networking sense of things. But I mean connecting and really connecting in the fact that they can understand you and you understand them. And in the sales context, don't we often encounter people that for whatever reason, we can't seem to properly understand their circumstance, their situation, what they want, what they need, what their problem is, where their pain is. Sure, it happens. I started out as a kid in retail. My roots were in the retail industry. One of the benefits of being a young person and working in retail, particularly in retail sales, and I don't mean clerking, I mean selling. And I worked in commission sales as a kid. You encounter a lot of different people, and the benefit of encountering a lot of different people is you encounter a lot of different kinds of personalities, a lot of different styles, a lot of different ages, a lot of different demographics of people. And it was helpful, I think. I really wouldn't take anything for it, because what that experience taught me was how to adjust my own communication style so that I could make that connection. The word that I've often used, and the one that I'm still quite fond of instead of connection, and you don't hear about it very much anymore, and I think it's terribly, terribly underrated when it comes to selling, and I think it's underrated when it comes to any kind of marketing effort, and that is rapport. Rapport. Creating, building rapport. At the heart of rapport building is our ability to effectively communicate with each other. I haven't often encountered people who couldn't speak English, which is the only language I do speak, sadly. But the times that I have, it's frustrating, isn't it? It's frustrating to try to communicate with someone that clearly does not speak your language and you don't speak theirs. And it can be equally frustrating when we get into these selling situations. And maybe, you know, for technical sake, we would call them these pre-qualifying or these qualifying or these discovery kinds of communications, where what we really are doing is we're kind of doing this delicate dance with a prospect to see, am I a good fit? Am I a proper fit to solve their problem? Are they a proper fit to be my customer? Are they our ideal or even somewhat ideal customer? We need to find this out. How can we do that? Well, we've got to talk to each other. We have to communicate with each other. And if we cannot effectively communicate, there is no hope that we'll do business together. It's just not going to happen. It's not going to happen. If you can't convey to me in ways that I can understand what your problems are, there's no way that I can help you. And there's no way that you're going to let me help you, because you're going to think, well, he doesn't even understand what I'm saying. He can't help me. And so the rapport it's out the window. Now, too oftentimes I find salespeople bent on selling. All right, we're going to sell. Rapport? No, we don't care about rapport. It's like badges. We don't need no stinking badges. We don't need no stinking rapport. We're selling, right? We're pitching. We're in there, and we think that the whole game is pitch. Pitch. And the more we pitch, the more we're going to sell. So every encounter we have with people, we're pitching. We're constantly pitching. There is never rapport building going on. And as a result, sales, yeah, you might get some. Blind pig finds one every now and then, but it's not likely to be a good way to run your career in sales. It's a good way to ruin it, but not run it. We need to create rapport, and the best way to create rapport is we've got to communicate. We have to be able to properly understand each other. Now, I have encountered some people who had a problem, had a difficulty. I had every reason to believe that I could solve the problem, or I was at least among the candidates to be able to ideally solve the problem, but they had an extraordinarily difficult time communicating it. It could be, and it can be, that sometimes we encounter people who just, they're just not that verbally adept. It happens. You know people like that. People that just, they have a real difficult time expressing themselves, at least verbally. I know other people that may have a tough time making me understand based on my limited ability. Take someone who may be just incredibly proficient at some technology. It could be someone who is an engineer. Take an aerospace engineer, somebody that's in this, you know, really technical field. Well, I'm not an aerospace engineer. I don't know how many, if I were to fill the Yellow Studio with aerospace engineers, I don't know how many I'd have to go through before I'd find one who I could kind of connect with just without trying, right? Probably it would be difficult because they live in a different world, and they do, people do in various occupations and industries, they do kind of speak their own language. Every industry, every kind of a job in an industry seems to have its own little vocabulary. So sometimes it's vocabulary issues. It's terminology that we may not understand. Sometimes it may be that people just have a really difficult time. I encountered an engineer here recently, and you could tell he was hardly a dim-witted person. And English was his first language, but you wouldn't have known it. Really, really difficult. The kind of guy that it was very tough for him to make eye contact. It was very, you could tell this was a person, probably put him in front of a computer with many monitors and who knows what kind of technical equipment, and probably right at home. But when engaging with other people, you could tell he was just, he was noticeably uncomfortable. What do we do about those kind of things? I'm just going to tell you what has worked for me and what does work for me. And that is take the pressure off. Take the pressure off. This is no longer a selling situation. It's a conversation. And the friendlier, the better. The less threatening, the better. And by threatening, I don't mean anything other than, you know, just to know that you're involved in a selling conversation, that you have on the phone a person who you know they would hope to sell you something. They would hope to solve your problem, and with the best intentions. But there's still pressure there. But what if we took that pressure off? What if that pressure doesn't exist? What if we're just now having a conversation with someone who's trying to better understand us and our circumstance and our situation? Well, I have found that it helps. And a few little tips and techniques that I think can work is, as we're embarking in these conversations, if you find yourself, it's just not happening. I don't think there's anything at all wrong, and I think, depending on your level of comfort in doing such things, I, for instance, have been very comfortable in sometimes rebooting conversations and have had no problem doing that. Now, I'm not saying this will work for you. I'm just throwing this out there and hoping you can take something from it. I have told people, listen, do you mind, you know, I apologize, but can we start over? I mean, I got off on a really bad foot because, you know, what I really want to do is I really want to learn about your situation here. Can you tell me about how this works or how that works? Tell me about this process or whatever it is that happens to be, you know, kind of the thing that you need to discuss. And once they begin talking, I'm pretty careful to not stomp them down with any and every phrase or word that they might mention that I may not understand. I'll write it down. And Google's a great thing, isn't it? Because we can sit here and, especially if we're dealing in something that's technical, people can throw out acronyms, they can throw out these little three-letter things, and I don't have a clue. I'm writing it down. I'm making a note. If this is a conversation that I'm having and I'm in front of a computer and I can do it where, I mean, it's not obvious that I'm doing it, I may Google it right there live while I'm talking to them. Now, sometimes that doesn't work. And I'm not saying you should get distracted with Google while you're having a conversation. It's a bad idea. Trust me. But don't stop every time you hear a word or a phrase that you don't understand. What I have found helpful is to simply ask the person, well, tell me more about that. And sometimes, again, you kind of have to read the situation. If I feel like I've got sufficient rapport, I'm working to build more rapport, I will absolutely positively be unabashed in asking, okay, now what is that? What is that again? What was that word, or what was that phrase, or what was that company? And tell me more about that. Tell me more about that. I've not heard that. You know, explain that. They will. The big deal here is it does no good for us to try to go in and pull the wool over someone's eyes and trying to patronize them and make them believe that there's this connection that's happening, there's this understanding that's going on, when there isn't. The other person can feel it. You can feel it. There's no profit in it. I determined a long time ago in these kinds of conversations, I'm not going to have this conversation if we can't get on the same page and understand each other. That would be about as profitable as me talking to you. If Italian were the only language you spoke and English is the only language I speak, we're stupid for spending our time together without a translator. We can't understand each other, and we could talk all day long, and I might love the sound of your voice. You might love the sound of my voice, but it's not going to get us anywhere, and it certainly isn't going to build any rapport. We've got to understand. Know this. When you ask people to tell you about their circumstance, their life, their situation, and we're talking again in a business setting, a selling setting, pre-selling setting, man, they're happy to tell you. They're just happy to tell you because so few people do. Most people do exactly what I said. I got something to sell. I'm pitching. The minute you say hello, I'm in pitch mode. No, I'm in understanding mode. I'm in rapport building mode. I'm in learning more about you, finding out more about you, finding out more about your circumstance, your situation, your problems, your pain, your desires, your wants, your hopes, your dreams, so that I can try to help accommodate those things. And if I can't get on the same page with you, I can't make that happen. Tell me more about that. I'd like to hear more about that. I've never, ever had a person say, no, I think I've told you enough. They're just not going to do that. I guess you could come into contact with somebody that's going to be a rude dog and do that, but I've never, in nearly 40 years of this, it's never happened to me. I've always, always had people happily accommodate to tell you more. And in that telling you more, you learn the things that you need to learn. But you know what may be even more important? You learn how they communicate, and you learn to communicate in that style. Maybe you've been in a room, someone's folded their arms, and within minutes you find yourself folding your arms. It happens, right? We have these conversations, and sometimes we have to pay more attention to this, I think, to do it verbally than to do this, because this may be kind of instinctual, subconscious. I think we have to work at the verbal in really listening, paying attention. And we understand how the other person communicates. And now we try to accommodate that. No, we're not patronizing, but we're trying to mirror the communication that seems to work best for them. Again, as with all things, preparation is key. Paying close attention is key. But unless there is rapport built, no sales are going to happen. My name is Randy Cantrell. The website is BulaNetwork.com. This is the Yellow Studio.